This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown. Because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant thing, dominant being. And because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive.
Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section.
I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess. And join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Hi there. This is Joe Exotic. And now for something completely similar. Y'all got any meth?
Jason, it's time.
Is it?
Time to rise and shine.
I thought it was Vader time.
To a brand new day.
I was led to believe that it was, in fact, Vader time.
It is. Well, let me just look at my watch here. It appears to be not Vader time yet.
No. Okay. Well, I can wait.
Okay. Well, we'll just sit here.
I got nowhere to be.
Yeah. Well, I'm waiting. I'm looking at my watch here. It's taking a while.
And the thing is, anybody who's listening to this right now, assuming things are still going the way they're going, they probably don't got nowhere to be either, Brendan.
All right, let's just hang out in silence.
All right.
So, okay, Jason, enough of this bullshit. Let's start with the show.
Show!
This is a podcast called For Screen
and Country.
And I am Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
And usually on this show, we talk to you about the BFI, that's the British Film Institute Top 100 British Films of All Time list. We talk about a different movie on that list each week. We break it down. Should it belong? Is it as good as they say? What kind of cultural impact does it have? How many references to Clerks will Jason make? Etc.
Etc. But for the last, I believe at this point, 15 years, we have been doing a series called And Now for Something Completely Similar, where we watch prequels, sequels, remakes, reinterpretations, interpretive dances of films that we've already watched that were on the British Top 100 list. And it's a great way for Brendan and I to have a little bit of a circle jerk during the quarantine.
Yeah, exactly. These episodes are a little looser, a little loosier, goosier.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because we've talked about some doozies in the last 15 years.
Yes. Oh, man. We have watched some movies.
Lawrence After Arabia.
Oh, my. Classic. So good.
39 Steps remake.
Why did they even make the first one? They should have just went with that one.
The sequel to Elizabeth. That was basically the same movie.
Yeah. I mean, it's what everybody demanded.
I mean, we've gotten through some doozies just to get to the movie we're going to talk about this week.
And that, Brendan, my friend, may sound very sarcastic to you, but I assure you that is not the case.
And that is the film Blowout.
Oh, man!
fucking right.
Pretty amazing opening credits.
Yeah, like for 1981, this was a credit sequence that was impactful. It was short and it was to the point. It had good sound effects. I mean, obviously, it's a movie, but
you have to. Yeah,
so you gotta. And even just that animation of the needle going back and forth is just so fucking cool, and I love it.
Yeah. So this is a Brian De Palma movie. I was going to say this is our first Brian De Palma movie, but I really doubt we're going to talk about any other ones.
Yeah, I would say now you and I certainly on your other podcast, what has to be 50 to 65 years ago, watched a film called Snake Eyes starring one Nicolas Cage and directed by one Brian De Palma.
Yeah, so he can really fall on either end of the quality spectrum is what we're trying to say.
Absolutely. He's got sort of a Paul Verhoeven quality in that way.
Yes. He can either be a Showgirls or a RoboCop.
But although to be fair, I would say even Showgirls is a fantastically entertaining film, even if it's
fine.
Not.
A Hollow Man or a RoboCop.
Okay, there we go. That's better.
So Brian De Palma's film, 1981, entitled Blowout. So this is kind of a remake in a way, or at least a retooling of a movie we talked about that was number 60 on the BFI Top 100 called Blow Up.
Yes.
Which was about a guy who is a photographer. He captures something in one of it when he's shooting some, you know, he's being a little bit of a perv, or at least a little voyeuristic. Taking some pictures, and he catches what appears to him to be potentially a murder, or at least the results of a murder. Mm-hmm. And he spends the rest of the film obsessing over that. And then at the end of Blow Up, we never really get an answer to quite frankly, anything.
I interpreted Blow Up as basically that he was he gets into his own head. He basically is seeing shit that isn't there because he's been so put on this path by the very idea of it, and he kind of falls into it. And if I remember correctly, Brendan, and I may be wrong, so please tell me if I am, is Blow Up not the movie that ends with him watching the mimes that showed up in the Jeep and they're playing a game of fake tennis?
Yes.
Yeah, so
And the big moment there is that he joins in.
He joins in. So I believe that's him kind of subsuming to his crazy or submitting to his crazy at that point. So in my mind, I believe that he's just nuts at the end of the movie. Like he's gone. He's so far gone that it doesn't matter. But that's a bit different in this movie.
It is a bit different. And while in that movie, we kind of follow him the whole time and we're not really sure what we're supposed to be believing because we see everything through our main character. This is a Brian De Palma film. So he does not do that because who does Brian De Palma, what filmmaker does Brian De Palma love more than any other, Jason?
Alfred Hitchcock?
Alfred Hitchcock. So in that Alfred Hitchcock manner, he doesn't like to make it a whodunit.
No.
He doesn't go for that. As we talked about, again, on the other podcast, we talked about Snake Eyes. In that movie, the twist comes 45 minutes into the movie.
Yeah.
In this movie, I think you know about 45 minutes, maybe even less than that, into the movie, that there's obviously something crooked afoot.
Yeah.
And you know that for sure because there are shots where our main character, played by John Travolta, is not even present. Like we actually see the bad guys kind of working their plan.
For me, the moment that the twist such that it is when everything kind of falls into place is shortly after kind of the nature of Sally is revealed and what her kind of objective was in the car at that time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Whereas in the original film, I believe we get Vanessa Redgrave and she's very mysterious. And then she just kind of like leaves the movie and we don't really know what that was all about, which is very cool in that movie. I think I really liked what that movie did because it was so different from what I expected. Like, you know, you expect a mystery, the setup, blah, 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 the end, whatever the end happens to be. Mm. And that just kind of turned the whole thing on its head. This is more in the line of I don't want to say generic because right off the top, I'll say, I think I speak for both of us. This movie is fantastic.
I agreed 100%.
I don't want to say generic, but I'll say straight down the middle. It's a very it's a thriller. It's a pretty standard thriller in terms of like the story makeup of it.
This is a movie, Brendan, where with Blow Up, we're watching a movie where we are questioning a character's sanity. Mm-hmm. This is a movie where Blowout is a movie where we as the viewer never – question the character's sanity. It's everybody else in the movie that questions the character's sanity.
It's one of those movies where you're with John Travolta.
Yes.
Getting mad because everyone's questioning him, being like, God damn, you fucking dummies. Just listen to what he's saying.
And that's the thing about the original is that in the original British one, we start out that way. Because that's just how movies are. And we assume that, you know, we're looking at this movie through the lens of the protagonist. But as that movie goes on, it becomes more and more clear that we're not necessarily getting the full story, or that that he's seeing things that we're not seeing, or we're missing things that he's seeing. Like, whereas again, this movie much more like we're on board with John Travolta from the get go, because we're there when it happens, we see it happen. And then that never really changes.
Exactly. And let's go through the cast in this movie then a little bit here, Jason, because we've got John Travolta playing the title role.
John Travolta in what has to be his like his first prime, like just fucking just greasy looking, but like still attractive and just great actor in this movie.
I think this is about 3 years after Grease.
Yeah. So this is young John Travolta at his peak.
So it's John Travolta playing the title role of Jack Terry. Nancy Allen, who is Brian De Palma's wife at the time. I don't know if they're still married, but it was Brian De Palma's wife, playing Sally, the female.
Now, did she play Tony Soprano's mom?
No, she did not.
That's a different Nancy.
that's a different actor altogether. Nancy Allen is still very much alive.
What do I know her from? Oh, RoboCop. She's from fucking RoboCop.
Oh, yeah, she is from RoboCop. You're right. Fuck, how did I not realize that?
Awesome. When I saw the picture of her with short hair, and it's like, oh yeah, I know who she is.
also appearing in the movie, John Lithgow plays the role of Burke, who is a fucking psychopath.
So good.
Or sociopath, you might say.
Like, and a character whose performance says everything about him that you could possibly need to know. Like, just the way he speaks and the way he goes about his business, like, this is a guy that you know not to fuck with. Even though we're never, like, ever clear on exactly who he is or like exactly what his position is, or like, is he in the army? Is he some sort of government agent? Is he a political operative? We're never quite sure.
Well, and you mentioned, since you're getting into that, I'll just mention the rest of the cast real quick.
Sure. Yeah.
Dennis Franz is Manny Karp, a slimy photographer who, like Jason said before we went on the air, has hair in this movie.
A full head of luscious hair. Now it's going away, but it's there.
John McMartin plays Lawrence Henry's, the detective that's interviewing Travolta at the beginning of the movie.
Yes.
Robin Sherwood is Betsy, and that is just a very small, brief role at the beginning as well. She's one of the couples that's like the couple that's like, what is that guy looking at us for? Is he spying? Is he a perv? Yeah. it's a very cool red herring too, which is that you have John Travolta. You think that this couple that you see on the bridge across from John Travolta is going to be, you know, the source of the whole movie. You think it's going to get the whole thing going, and then it ends up being a total red herring, has nothing to do with the rest of the movie.
Yeah.
Which I think was pretty good. Which I think was pretty cool, and I only realized after. But anyway, before we go any further, you mentioned John Lithgow as Burke.
Yes.
Just giving you every indication of who he's supposed to be, just with his delivery.
Yeah.
And I want to play. I think the best example of that is when he's speaking on the telephone to his like handler, talking about the mission basically, and just listen to how cold and calculating and just fucking evil he is.
You were supposed to get some pictures of McGrath, not kill him.
I understood the objectives of the operation. I never concurred with them.
But I didn't kill him. It was an accident.
You accidentally shot out the tire of his car?
As you may recall, this was my initial plan as proposed at our meeting of June the 6th.
We rejected that plan, don't you remember?
Of course, I do admit I had to exceed the parameters of my authority somewhat, but I always stayed within an acceptable margin of error.
After all, the objective was achieved. He was eliminated from the election.
Burke, I don't know you. I've never seen you. Don't ever call me again.
Just a minute, sir. We got some loose ends.
I changed the tire, made it look like a blowout. I erased the sound guy's tape so everybody will think he's a crackpot. Karp's disappeared, but I'll find him. But that still leaves the girl. I've decided to terminate her and make it look like one of a series of sex killings in the area.
This would completely secure our operation.
What operation?
Yeah, so just fucking, just like a cold-blooded serial killer. I said psychopath, but I think he may be a sociopath.
Well, it I would say he's an android. He is a robot through and through. He sounds like Data going through the motions of this thing. And that's what I love about it. It's just, it's so businesslike. It's very military. Just because he calls the guy sir, and the way he, you know, the objective was achieved in this manner, like he's very officious in his speaking, and I like that.
I will say
he's
this.
Also a fucking nut job, but we'll get to that. Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say I will say this, that I for my work I take phone calls, yeah. And when people call with this kind of delivery, like with this kind of manner of speaking where everything is so precise and like ordered, it creeps me out.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is absolutely creepier than someone calling and being like, hey.
My thought usually though with that sort of voice is, what is this person gonna try to sell me?
I mean, there's me. That. There's that too. When I am the person receiving the calls at work though, I don't get to wonder about that, but
you don't get solicited on the phone. Nobody tries to sell you shit. Well, it's like, oh, by the way, would you like to buy some Tupperware or some
while I'm working?
Yeah. Yeah. They call in and they like need to like deal with whatever information you have to give them. Then they're like, oh, by the way, would you be interested in some Pampered Chef baking stones?
Can't say that I do.
Oh, well, that's a market that needs to be tapped. Oh, man, like reverse spam. You call like telemarketers and try to sell them shit. Oh, my God.
Jesus Christ.
I'm gonna put that in my back pocket and get back to this movie, because this movie deserves our talk.
Well, I want to get back into John Lithgow just for a moment, because we talked about how he's cold, he's calculating. He never seems like a stereotypical villain. Like, no. He's very like wet, like I said, mannered, ordered. He has everything in control. Like, he casually says in that clip what he's going to do. So just to get the basic premise out of the way, John Travolta is a sound guy.
Yeah.
He does sound for like bad movies, basically bad horror movies, schlocky
sorts of
stuff.
Movies that you watch on your other podcast.
That's right. in October. So he does the sound guy, and basically the guy, his director, or you know, whoever the director of this next movie is, basically tells him like, your sound is shit. You're just reusing the same library. Go out and get me some good ambient sounds and like a nighttime and you know, owls and frogs and crickets and shit. So he's out doing that, and in the course of doing that, he accidentally records a car crash. And he kind of obsesses over it because he goes in under the water. He notices that there is a young lady stuck in the car. The gentleman has passed away. He does manage to save the young lady, played by Nancy Allen, who he finds out. And he finds out that the guy in the car was a governor, a very popular governor that basically was going to be president one day. They make that very clear in the movie. He was, if he had been, if there was an election today, yes. 63% said he would be the president.
And actually that sequence where we learn that is some very, what I have to imagine is some very early examples of the use of split screen in a film. It seems very cutting edge for 1981, where we're watching
staple.
Yeah. And where we're watching kind of on one side of the screen, we're watching him working with all this cool old sound equipment as he's like, you know, banking sound effects and whatever. And then on the right side of the screen, we're watching a TV screen that is being filmed and it is showing a news broadcast, which, of course, is a trope we see in many movies as far as like how to get some exposition out. We watch news broadcasts, but it's really cool watching it in this. And actually in this scene, as he's getting these sound effects, the sound effects, at least to me, seem to be relevant to what's going on, because we have a sound effect of we see the politician, and there's a sound effect of glass breaking that he does, but then there's a sound effect of a gunshot when we see him on screen, and then there's a sound effect of a body hitting the floor. Yeah.
It's wild, and it's not done in a way you might expect like modern De Palma to do it. I feel like modern day De Palma is a little more on the nose. As we see in the movie, again, going back to Snake Eyes, there is a scene of literal blood money landing on the ground. So, I mean, there's that. But yeah, I feel like he does it a lot more subtly here. And it's actually only something I noticed back when I was going back over the movie to get some clips for the show. I was like, holy shit, that's right. Because, yeah, you see like the on the TV, they're talking about the governor, and you just hear that little gunshot sound effect in the background. I didn't even pick up on that the first time. So for the rest of the movie, basically, he's trying to unravel this conspiracy. Like, what is going on? Why did the car crash? Why did I hear a gunshot right before the car crashed? Who was somebody trying to kill the governor? What does the girl have to do with it? And that's kind of how the rest of the movie goes. Now, what I was going to say is, John Lithgow's character, is very cold and everything, but when he has to be, he can just like turn it off.
Yeah.
And he's like a normal guy. Like he seems like he could be a normal guy when he's talking to Sally. Later on, we'll talk about that.
Well, or I even feel like when he's turning it on there, I feel like he is this just like emotionless husk. And when he needs to, like, that's the psychopath kind of idea, is that he has no like kind of feelings or personality of his own, but he can accurately mimic what he has observed others doing and then can deploy that to his advantage, which he clearly does.
That's what I mean, though. I mean, I think his real personality is this emotionless husk, and I think he turns it off.
Yeah.
When he, you know, has to.
And then he's gonna turn it on, baby.
Yeah. Okay. But that was the thing I was gonna say. So this is a guy who he sees Sally as a loose end, because basically we find out that she and Manny, played by Dennis Franz, is it Franz or Franz?
I mean, I think he'd say it Dennis Franz because he's from Chicago and he sounds like this.
Thank you, Dennis Franz.
Dennis Franz. I'm from South Side of Chicago. I like a hot beef once in a while. Deep dish, real good. Get it over on, Chicago Street.
Did you check out our show when we said shit? That was crazy.
And then I showed my ass on TV. Oh!
Oh, millions of babies were born that night.
I went home and fucked my wife so many times that night.
Because she got jealous of how many people saw my ass.
That's right. That's right. Thank
so
you
anyway.
That was the Dueling Friends. Thank you.
Yes. John Belushi and Peter Boyle are rolling over in their graves. but anyway, what the fuck is it? Yeah, so we find out that she's kind of in on schemes with him. Basically, they get these well-known or famous people to get caught in bed with her. Mm. And he sells those pictures to the highest bidder. So that's just what he was doing with the governor here. And then, of course, because he took video of it and, you know, Travolta has the audio of the accident, Lithgow sees Sally as a loose end. And in order to cover up the fact that he wants to eventually murder her, he commits a series of quote-unquote sex killings of women that look exactly like her.
This is the most fucked up thing about this movie.
That is a fucking – I mean, I'm watching it and I'm like – that's fucking genius, and I hate that I said that.
It's genius, but it's also like it's an incredible amount of work to go to like, I guess, get the trail off yourself or get the trail off of your whole reasoning for doing this, like setting up this whole alternate like this alternate criminal existence as a quote unquote serial killer just to kill this one girl so people don't think it was you that did it. Like that's just, it's genius, and it's just so much fucking work.
It's some fucked up shit, man.
It's very fucked up. I mean, especially the fact that he goes and he, like, because I was watching it, right? And you see him walking through the market, right? And he grabs an ice pick. So I'm thinking, okay, he's just going to stab her. But then he goes and he fucking strangles her. And I'm thinking, why'd he grab the ice pick? And he gets her down on the ground. And he starts stabbing her in the stomach. And it's like, what the fuck? And then it turns out that he's stabbing the shape of the Liberty Bell. Because he's tying it into this celebration that's going on at this time called like Liberty 1981 or whatever. It's like a big, you know, rah, rah America kind of thing, celebration.
What I think happens though, is when he kills that first girl, I think he thought it was Sally.
Yes, that was my thought too, is that he just made a mistake. And then now he's got to fix his mistake with this whole serial killer bullshit.
Yeah.
To cover up his mistake.
Listeners. He kills the wrong lady, and then to cover it up, he sees the sign for like the Liberty Bell party or whatever, right?
And immediately he comes to the conclusion in his head.
Yeah.
This is what I can do.
I will carve the Liberty Bell into her stomach and make the media, you know, the media is definitely going to pick up on it, you know, the Liberty Bell killer. And then I will just kill people that look similar to her. And then when I eventually make my move to try and kill Sally, they will just assume it was the spree of a murderer. That is the kind of character we are dealing with here. What do you think? So moving away from Lithgow for a moment, because I just wanted to talk about a lot.
We can talk about him for two fucking hours. Easy.
We sure could.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the way the movie opens
With
a schlocky horror movie.
Yeah, and me being very confused right off the bat, being like, wait, what? What movie are we watching? Because I'm watching, you know, where the cops walking up the window, and the girls are in the dorm room, and they got their titties flopping around, and they're dancing, and then there's a couple that's getting fucked, and I'm watching the cop watching them, thinking like, huh? And then the guy stabs him, and it's like, okay, so is this the murder that he records? And then we start having the camera going through, and the girls are all around, and the guy is walking through, like, the house. We're sort of from his perspective, but we know we're from his perspective because at one point he goes into the bathroom and we see him in the mirror. So he's like, this fat guy in a tracksuit is like silently stalking around this dorm and nobody notices him. So we see all manner of stuff that we would expect in a schlocky, like, horror film, but of course that confused me because, again, didn't expect this in this movie that I was watching, where we have the girls dancing around in their underwear. Then we have a couple fucking in the next room. And then at one point we even pan through a room where a girl is just going to town on herself on the couch.
Yeah, they hit you with all this, like, stimuli, like, crazy. Yeah. And the
soundtrack with the breathing, like, this heavy breathing that underlies everything that's going on.
It's very, like, the POV stuff with the knife and everything, it kind of reminded me of Halloween.
Yeah.
Because Halloween would have come out, like, 3 years before this.
And it makes sense they would be aping that.
Yeah, very big on everyone's mind. I wonder if this is De Palma taking a little bit of a shot at Halloween.
Oh, baby.
Because they him and Carpenter, or at least, you know, as far as people knew Carpenter at the time, are making two completely different kinds of thrillers, of, you know, horror movies. This is kind of a horror movie in a way. It's a thriller, yeah, for sure. But I wonder if this is De Palma taking a shot at those kind of schlocky movies and being like, no, no, all this shit you see at the beginning, that's just a movie. Now let's watch the real thing.
Yeah.
because we know, and it's the moment we know it's obviously not real is when we hear that horrible scream.
Yeah.
By the girl in the shower. Yeah. And we have this whole conversation between Travolta and his director about, like, oh, people are coming to see your tits. Actually, you know what? Let's just listen to a little bit of that
scream. Yeah.
Let's just listen to a little bit of that conversation.
Kill it. You're right. It's hers. And it's shit. Look, Jack, I didn't hire that girl for her scream. I hired that girl for her tits.
Well, then what are you worried about? With those tits, who's going to be watching her scream? Let's move on.
But wait a minute, wait a minute. Come on, Jack. Look, how many years have we worked together?
Let's see. I met you on Bloodbath, right?
Yeah.
And then we did Bloodbath 2. And then we did Bad Day at Blood Beach. And then we did Bordello of Blood. And then, well, that brings us up to date. Co-ed Frenzy. By the way, I didn't tell you this, but I'd like to think this is our finest film.
Almost 2 years.
Oh, God, 2 years. 5 films in 2 years. How do we do?
You know what I can't figure out? I can't figure out what a smart guy like you is still doing that shit for.
Oh, come on. You do this shit. I do the sound.
You do the shit.
Oh, is that
right?
Yeah,
like that wind in the trees. It sounds like you're whistling in the crap.
That's the library stuff. We used it a million times.
That is the trouble. I have heard it a million times. Now get something new.
New wind.
Yeah.
Got it.
And what about that scream? We gotta dub that.
All right. You know any good screamers?
I got a few ideas.
Yeah, I bet you do.
Yeah, yeah. Just worry about the scream, will you, huh?
So that's that, and that's actually that's even before the opening credits. It's a good way to establish the movie right off the bat. What's sick about that, and I mean that, like, dark humor in that moment, is that pays off at the end of the film, and we'll talk about that later.
Yes, yes.
But man, oh man,
ending of this movie.
Man, oh man, when that reveal came, that just blew my mind.
So, also, did you notice that during his listing of movies, he lists a movie called Bordello of Blood?
It's a real movie 10 years later.
Well, 15 years later. But yeah. Yes, with Tales from the Crypt presents Bordello of Blood. So I wonder if they specifically got that title from this movie, or if it was just a, you know, because Bordello of Blood, I mean, that's not a crazy phrase to think of, I suppose.
Jason, let me ask you this, though.
Okay.
What genius starred in that movie, babe?
Well, since I have Wikipedia pulled up here, I can tell you that it's probably Dennis Miller.
Wow. Joni really? Loves tchotchke. You know what I mean?
Why Dennis Miller? Why?
They needed someone to wisecrack with the devil. Eh?
Starts as Rafe Gutman, a private investigator. Of course. Why wouldn't he be?
Sounds like a stereotypical fat character John Goodman would play.
Should we do that movie next week? Because it's actually related to this movie.
Rafe Gutman.
Yeah, that's a John Goodman name for sure.
So I don't know. So like the way that whole opening is shot, I feel like it's De Palma taking a shot at other filmmakers.
Why not? Why not? Give it to him, Brian.
And we should talk about De Palma's own style, because this is, I feel like, out of everyone, and yes, we could talk about how much he apes another filmmaker's, certain filmmaker's style, but out of a lot of filmmakers, he's one of the few that I watch a De Palma movie and I like immediately know it's Brian De Palma.
Yeah, well, the things that got me in this one that I specifically remember from Snake Eyes were the split screen, but also the top down shot of a couple of scenes where
the overhead.
It's an entire sequence in Snake Eyes, but in this movie, there's just a couple of shots that are taken from that perspective that are very De Palma-esque. And I haven't seen Scarface in a long time, but I assume there must be those sorts of shots in there too.
I remember the chainsaw scene had plenty of split screen.
Yeah.
And I am sure in that 3-hour movie, there are some overhead shots.
It's gotta be.
Yeah. He also really likes using the red filter, which I think is interesting because that's almost like a photo developing filter.
Yes. Yes. And also it gives a real like seedy feel to every scene, 'cause it's got that red light district kind of, aura that it projects, at least that I see, 'cause I'm a degenerate.
And so like, and this also like introduces the whole, so the whole movie is, it's very voyeuristic, obviously, because we have Travolta kind of, you know, he's out recording sound. He sees a couple, he kind of puts his microphone in their direction. And by the way, that microphone is amazing.
Yeah. It's a great microphone
because he hears everything they're saying from like a long way away.
You'd think you'd need like a dish on it or something for that kind of range, but not that mic.
No, not that mic. I do like how the way the microphone looks, when he points it directly at the screen, it's almost like the barrel of a gun.
Mm. He's the James Bond of sound engineering.
Oh, I would love to see a John Travolta as a sound engineer, but like a James Bond mystery where he walks across the screen and just points that at the screen. and then you just hear like really loud breathing. There's lots of other, another one that he really does, that he does really well. And this scene is long. It's the shot that he does where he spins around the entire room several times. And it's the scene where Travolta goes back to his office and all of his tapes have been erased.
Yeah.
And we know obviously, that Lithgow is the one that's done it. Like Burke is the one that's gone and done it. And it's a scene that just takes its time. Like it's not, they're not rushing or anything. It goes around the entire room slowly. We see Travolta kind of in and out a few times of the shot and we realize it's kind of him like having a breakdown.
Yeah. Because it's totally building to that crescendo, I guess. It's got this like throbbing heartbeat almost underneath the soundtrack as the camera spins around. And yeah, it's really, really projecting this idea of like this kind of breakdown moment.
Mm-hmm. And that's when he starts to lose it. Like honestly, from that point on, his character has a whole different look. Yeah. Like he looks more disheveled. He looks more out of his element, which I mean, he does, to be fair, that most of the movie, but
well, it kind of drives it home at that point how serious it is that somebody's broke into his space and then actually gone to the trouble of erasing all these tapes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, that would set you off. That's a whole new level to this thing that he's been involved in.
So since we're talking about Travolta a little bit, I've got to ask you. Oh.
Oh, I just did. Oh, because whenever you say Travolta, I just think, oh, Vinnie Barbarino.
Oh my God, Mr. Connor, you're gonna die, I swear.
That is
Quentin Tarantino's Welcome Back, Cotter. Watch that sketch, it's great. There is a what I was gonna ask you is,
yeah,
so since we're talking about John Travolta, I have to tell you who the original choice for this role was, because I have to ask how you think this would go. So keep in mind this is 1981. And keep in mind who De Palma has worked with before. Brian De Palma's original choice for this role of Jack Terry was going to be Al Pacino.
Yeah. And you know what? I think Al Pacino would have been fine. Because this movie, I don't know why, because it's a very different movie, but this movie reminds me of Dog Day Afternoon in some way, and I don't know exactly why, but maybe it's the aesthetic, maybe it's the feel of it, but I think Al Pacino would be fine in this. I don't think we'd have an issue. I think the movie would probably still be pretty good, but John Travolta is just so fucking good in this that it'd be hard to imagine someone else in the role.
It made me kind of sad how good John Travolta was in this because I think of John Travolta now and I'm like, God damn it. It's been a long time since you've been in something.
What was that movie he was bald in? He played like a federal agent.
Are you thinking about From Paris with Love?
No. Let's see here. Was it Yeah, it was Savages.
Oh, okay.
Fucking Savages. That's a crazy movie.
Oh, well, there you go.
That's about a, what is it? I think it's a lady and she's in a three-way relationship with two other dudes.
All I know is that it's Ridley like Scott.
Drugs or something. Is it Ridley Scott?
I think it is.
No, it's Oliver Stone.
Oh, okay. I knew it was like a big director.
Yeah. It's a weird
So anyway, Al Pacino doesn't do this movie, obviously. And John Travolta actually lobbied pretty hard to get Nancy Allen cast in the movie. Nancy Allen, of course, Brian De Palma's wife.
He had to lobby to get the director's wife cast?
Well, here's why. So Travolta thought Nancy Allen would be great in this movie. And I mean, I think she is great. She's wonderful.
Oh, she is. She's so naturalistic in this movie. Like, yes. The way she speaks feels like documentaries I've seen of people from around that time. And I mean, she's not always like that. Because in RoboCop, it's a pretty conventional performance and she's great. But just something about this movie comes off as so natural.
Yeah, so natural to the point where at the beginning I was thrown off by it and I thought like there's something off about this and I don't know what it is, and then I realized like, oh no, she's the most realistic person in this movie.
Yeah, absolutely.
But no, the reason he had to kind of lobby for her to be cast in this movie, because De Palma was kind of getting a little bit of heat at the time, because a lot of people were like, oh, this guy just rips off Hitchcock and throws his wife in the movie. So he was kind of
he was the Tarantino of his day.
Well, come on. Tarantino doesn't have a wife.
Rob Zombie of his day.
There you go. All
right.
I guess Tarantino's married now, but I don't think he's throwing her in his movies.
Good God, what woman would marry Quentin Tarantino?
I mean, he's a very rich man.
He is very rich.
But... So he hesitated at first, and he didn't want to have he didn't want to have a reputation for her only working in his movies, because basically she was only doing his movies for like quite a while.
Yeah.
But then he was like convinced. He's like, yeah, you know what? You're right. She's a great actor. She's my wife. Yeah. Don't take my wife, please.
My wife.
Everybody loves that, right? We'd be still doing that.
Well, I think that's one of those ones that's come back around. It was like kind of like Schwing for a long time where you couldn't do it and you came off as an asshole. But now it's been long enough that it's cool again.
Did you get elements of this movie of like the Chappaquiddick thing?
I didn't think about it at the time, but yeah, obviously now that you mention it, clearly, like especially the car going into the water. I mean, specifically
with a politician and a lady, like that would have been, because that would have been 19.
It was like a strikes back against Chappaquiddick, because in this version, the politician fucking dies in the river and the lady is saved.
That's right. It's like if the lady ran away and for a day didn't say anything.
So this whole movie is an anti-Ted Kennedy screed.
There you go. I doubt it, because I think De Palma is a very outspoken liberal. But the Chappaquiddick thing also, like, I think there's elements of Watergate and JFK just with all the political conspiracy things. But yes. He actually went ahead and said that they tried so hard to downplay any of those similarities. They said it's bound to happen, but it's only going to be incidental. Like, it's only in the sense that there's a conspiracy and that, you know, with Chappaquiddick, it was a car going in the river with a politician and a lady. But he's like, he tried not to kind of draw allusions to that sort of stuff.
Well, and he went out of his way. Because like the governor's party is never mentioned and the president is mentioned, but yeah. He's not given a name. He's literally on TV listed as the president.
I don't believe we even hear the governor talking. I think we might see him in a quick shot on TV. But yeah, I mean, in this movie, see,
like, B-roll of him on TV, and then we see his corpse in the car when he rescues her.
Like, no actor in this movie is credited as playing the governor. Like, it's not really a character in this movie.
No. Michael Keaton? Michael Keaton in The Big Chill?
Kevin Costner.
Kevin Costner, right. Kevin Costner.
Yeah.
I always confuse those two.
Is that why Kevin Costner played a corpse in that movie? Is because he wanted to do a tribute to Gilbert Gottfried's best character on SNL?
Absolutely. That's
the that's what I thought. The other thing, the other little tidbit that I wrote down here that I thought was kind of interesting is there's a scene where Dennis Franz is watching a movie on TV.
Yeah.
It's the first movie that De Palma ever made. It's called Murder a la Maud.
Yes.
he was originally going to watch a movie called Dementia 13, but Roger Corman wanted too much money for the rights, which I think is hilarious. Roger Corman, like the most frugal man on the planet.
But that makes the idea of him putting his own movie in the movie much more palatable. Because at first you're just like, oh, this asshole is showing his fucking first student film in here. But I could see why. It was a cost-cutting measure.
Here's a crazy thing, too, is this whole backstory we get for John Travolta. Because it's a really interesting backstory is we find out that he used to be he used to work for the police.
Yeah.
He used to catch like corrupt police officers.
Yeah, he worked for like Internal Affairs. Oh.
Yeah, he did like wire work, like he would actually put the wires together on informants. That whole sequence where we see the informant with the wire and, you know, ended up getting killed in the bathroom and everything, most of that sequence, aside from Travolta, obviously, was actually taken from an abandoned movie called Prince of the City, which ultimately that movie was made – that was then made into a movie directed by Sidney Lumet. But that was taken from an abandoned project.
That was weird. It's such a weird thing. And then they added the shots of Travolta, and that's neat.
Yeah. I thought that was interesting. That whole thing comes back too in a crazy dark way.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's referred to near the end of the movie. well, I could say, because at some point he's chasing down, trying to meet up with Sally as she's going to meet with the alleged journalist, which is in fact John Lithgow, Burke. And he drives through a parade, this massive parade that's going on to celebrate the Liberty Bell or whatever. And he somehow manages to go through this parade, not kill anyone on the way, but he crashes into a store. And in the store, they have a really dark display depicting was it Daniel Patrick somebody? I don't know. The famous American hero being hanged in the window. He's got a fucking noose around his neck and he crashes into that store. And then I thought that was like a little bit of callback to that. The fact because the guy had been hanged in the bathroom.
Well, and also the fact that there's a lot of stuff with the neck in this movie, because Lithgow, what's his modus operandi is he's choking people to death.
He's got that sweet fucking watch that has the face frame that pops off, and then he pulls it out of his watch, and he's got a Garrett wire that's inside that can snap back in. That's some awesome spy shit.
Yeah, he interrupts the best prostitute negotiation of all time.
Mm-hmm. I got $20 in 20 minutes.
I think he got 30 minutes.
Well,
I guess I do.
And then when this actually goes down in the phone booth, which is just the perfect place to do it, it really only takes about 25 to 30 seconds.
And then he gives her $10.
He gives her $10, which was not what they agreed upon. I mean, I get it. It wasn't very long, but that was on him, not on her. She just did a really good job. That wasn't his fault or her fault.
But yeah, so what's really cool about this movie is that little things set up at the beginning of the movie do come back. In very macabre ways. So before we get through that, though, I want to ask you the big question, because this is a big debate about Brian De Palma. And sure. I want to know, first of all, how many... So what Brian De Palma movies have you seen? You've obviously seen this.
You've seen this.
Scarface
many years
Mission
ago.
Mission to Mars,
yes, absolutely. Classic which I didn't film. Realize that he had directed it until now. Yeah. And I have not seen it since the theater, and I don't remember liking it very much, and finding the end part where Tim Robbins takes his fucking helmet off in space is just like, fuck you, Brian De Palma. And I've seen The Untouchables.
Yeah, that's a great movie.
Great, but beyond that, I'm not sure. Just let me look him up here and see what he's up to. And Snake Eyes, obviously.
Mm-hmm. But what I was gonna ask you in regards to that, just as a general thing, because the big debate about Brian De Palma is obviously, there's no debate about the fact that he loves Alfred Hitchcock. And he has homages to him a lot. I'm going to ask you this: in his work, the work that you've seen, do you find his stuff homage, or do you think it's almost aping it too much in like getting into like kind of ripoff territory.
You know, that's the funny thing, Brendan, because the other movie I just noticed I'd seen his, I did see Mission Impossible.
Okay.
The original one, obviously. But like, I, most of his movies I saw before I ever really considered film in a way that I do now after becoming a movie nerd in the early 2000s. A lot of those movies I just had seen before that and didn't really think about it. So this is the first time I've watched it. Well, I guess the second time we watched Snake Eyes, but first time I've watched a De Palma movie and really thought about it as a De Palma movie and his style. Mm-hmm. I'd be interested to watch Mission to Mars again, just to see how his style manifests in that science fiction movie.
So do you think, but do you think having watched this, that there's any merit to that, to that argument?
What was the argument again?
Just the fact, just the basically, some people say homage, some people say homage, some people say it's too close, like it's rip off
territory. Give a fuck, that's the thing.
Oh, you know what, I just thought of another. Go ahead, do the thing
again. I was gonna say, I don't give a fuck, because at the end of the day, like, you can say, ask the same question to Quentin Tarantino and it doesn't fucking matter. I don't care. You could say Quentin Tarantino's ripped off every single thing he's done, doesn't matter. He's taken those things that he's ripped off and he has recombined them into something that is new and unique and unique to him. And I think De Palma is similar, where, yeah, sure, he is heavily inspired by Hitchcock and other people, but he does his own thing with it. He's not just doing a straight like take on how they did movies. He's doing his own thing, and that's fine. That's absolutely fine. If you're going to steal, you steal from the best, right?
And I mean, I'm here for everything you said. I think yeah, you're not necessarily, just because you're aping someone's style, or you know, you're giving doing an homage, it doesn't mean you're completely ripping them off. And like you said, Tarantino would have something to say about that.
It's only ripping it off if it ends up being bad.
Mm-hmm.
If it's good, then it's an homage.
There you go. Other couple Hitchcock staples. You know what? This actually kind of reminded me in a way of Rear Window in that regard. Yeah. Because you have a character who maybe shouldn't be, you know, spying. Or maybe shouldn't delve deeper into the stuff that he's seeing.
Yeah.
I mean, in the sense that in this movie, if he didn't, he literally wouldn't have been able to save that woman's life.
Yeah.
But you know, he should maybe keep out of it. Another Hitchcock thing is that this whole this big staple that he has is, a lot of times in a Hitchcock movie, he has the climax take place at a really big event or a big arena or a real thing. I don't know if the Liberty Festival is like a real thing. I don't know if it's a real thing, but he always has a giant climax in most of his movies.
Yeah, and actually funny, and I'm sure you know this little bit of trivia, but I saw it mentioned somewhere that when they were, well, after they had filmed this, a couple of reels of film had gotten stolen from this sequence, the Liberty sequence, so they had to actually stage some reshoots to fix the movie, and it cost them a bunch of extra money because they had to get all those people back together.
Yeah, and De Palma was also not happy, by the way. Speaking of money, he wasn't happy that the studio gave him so much money for this movie. They gave him $18 million to make this movie in 1981. And he said, he said, I didn't need it. He said, I didn't need $18 million to make the movie I was making. And I think a lot of that ties into why this movie, quite frankly, this movie does not do well at the box office.
That's crazy.
Yeah, this movie cost $18 million to make, and it only made $13.8 million.
Yeah, so he should have done it cheaper.
Yeah, like he wanted to do it cheaper, and for some reason they just wouldn't let him. I mean, since we're talking about this in you know, these movies in comparison with movies on the list, we should probably talk about some other stuff about the similarities, some of the similarities or differences with Blow Up, the movie on the BFI Top 100.
Sure.
I mean, much like this movie, we'll get to the ending a little bit more detail, but the ending of this movie also sees the main character survive without really solving anything.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a pretty bleak ending, all things considered. The cover-up is basically successful because, as John Travolta, like you said, he is willing to give all of the evidence that he has to a reporter. Burke impersonates the reporter. We'll just say it here.
The guy's phone lines, like he literally was able to like cut the phone off so that the reporter couldn't get a hold of Jack, and then calls what's her face there, Sally.
Sally, yeah.
And pretends to be the reporter, which makes sense because she's never seen or talked to the reporter, so she wouldn't know any different.
Yeah, and he does that, and then he, you know, meets up with Sally. Let's just say right here, he kills her.
Yeah.
And the main, and you know, Jack makes it and ends up killing Burke, but in the end, she's dead, and he has no idea why the cover up, why the whole thing went down.
That's a crazy sequence too, because it's like he's running through the crowd. She's screaming from he's up near there's a big American flag and they're ringing a Liberty Bell and there's fireworks and stuff going off. And he runs after her like to save her, like you would expect in a movie like this, like the crescendo of the movie, he's running to try to save her. But he actually does get there too late and she's already been strangled. And so he grabs the ice pick and struggles with him and fucking stabs him in the stomach a few times. And then my thought is like, OK, so how's he getting into this? Because it's going to look like he killed both these people.
That's what I thought, too, actually. Yeah.
And then it turns out that the news just assumes that she killed him.
Out of self-defense
before dying herself. And then he's able to go back to his life with nothing resolved and a lot of trauma in his head. Mm-hmm. Because then we get to the big moment.
Well, let's play the big moment, because if you remember earlier in the film, guys, they were not able to find a good scream, a realistic scream for the shitty horror movie at the beginning of the movie.
I guess we should mention then, too, that during that entire ending sequence, she was wired with a microphone, yes. And he yes. has a portable listening device that seems to be about 95 pounds and that he has to drag around with him so that he can have an earphone.
And that's also tying into his past failure, past guilt and failure, where he actually we talked about how he wired an informant. Yeah. And that whole sequence, basically what happened, the informant started sweating, the radio got staticky, and the mob guys got suspicious and killed him. They hung him in the bathroom.
Staticky and, wasn't the right way. It was actually arcing. It was arcing.
Yeah, well, there was
burning him.
There was static on the radio is what I mean.
And the static on the radio was indicating, yeah, that the battery was going haywire, basically burning him. And that's why he's like, oh, I got to go take a piss at the next gas station, because he's trying to not like show that he's being excruciatingly burned by electricity.
Yeah. So, and because of that whole guilt, normally in a movie like this, you think, oh, okay, so he's got this guilt over what he did. So this is kind of be his not his comeback, but a kind of rectifying of that whole situation.
Redeeming himself.
Yeah. His redemption, but it ends up being his undoing again. So it's just like piled on top. And because of this whole thing, he's just obsessively listening to her last moments, as he has recorded. And it just leads to this moment. And I'm sure even without it explaining, you can get the idea of what's happened here. That's how the movie ends, is that he's taken the scream, this moment, the last moment of this girl's real life, and put her scream in this horror movie to get that scream redubbed.
A fitting memorial to a woman who was murdered.
Oh, man. It's well, and, you know, at first when I watched it, I was like, man, how fucked up is that? And then I thought about, like, is this his way of punishing himself? Because this is like, he must feel the most guilt in the whole world. Because exactly. If you watch throughout this movie, she wants to leave this situation so many times.
Yeah.
And he's always pulling her back in. And I think this is the ultimate moment where he's realized, I could have just let this girl go home. At the beginning of the movie, she wanted to take a train and leave. And if he had just let that happen, you know, he probably feels like that would have just avoided everything else.
The government guys gave her a bunch of money and said, get the fuck out of town. And she didn't, because he asked her to stay.
Yeah. Burke probably wouldn't have even bothered with her. Just everything. It's wild. He could
have gone back to his life and been working with the ladies getting the scream he needs, but instead a woman died and he got the scream he needed.
Yep. Well, let's bring up the mood a little bit, because I want to play, speaking of the scream, I want to play my favorite scene.
All right.
And this is when he's in the midst of investigating what's going on with the whole murder thing. And the director calls him in to hear a few quick auditions.
This is the pivotal moment in the film. You got to realize that. Hey, Jack, where the fuck are you going?
Sam, I'll be right back.
Okay? I need you now. Now get in here. What do you think?
Keep looking.
Keep looking.
I love that scene.
Just fun. Just funny. I like it.
Yeah. But man, yeah, it's such a bleak ending, but it's also such like a, it's like the darkest of dark humor. Yes. In that we get the cap of that moment at the beginning, which you think is so inconsequential, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's just this tiny moment of him, just a normal everyday job thing of like, oh, we got to find a scream because this one is not working.
and that's almost another Hitchcock thing. I know we haven't talked about, actually, no, sorry. This isn't the movie we talked about. The 39 Steps. Yeah. That movie opens with that whole Mr. Memory scene, right?
Mm.
Yeah. Of Mr. Memory, you know, this guy who has this amazing memory. He's telling people like, oh, it was him who won the heavyweight title in 1926. And this happened on this train at this time. And you're like, oh, it's just a funny little scene to bring us into the world of the movie. And then you think it's nothing. And then, of course, later at the end of the movie, it pays off in the biggest way. Again, it's a Hitchcock thing. But it's like the darkest version of a Hitchcock like tie-in.
Yeah. I noticed on your list there you have the makeup tutorial scene listed, and I wanted to actually mention that scene because I really like that scene because it kind of shows how similar the two of them are in their professions, where mm-hmm. he's a sound engineer and she's a makeup artist, and it really drove home to me the idea that these are both people that are doing something that if they have done their job to absolutely 100% perfection, you never notice them. You never notice their work. At all.
Oh,
it's just
really
there. It's like it's just accepted as part of the whole thing. It's only when it's bad that you notice it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think when it's good, you can appreciate it later. But yeah, I definitely agree with you.
But it doesn't stick out in the same way.
Yeah.
If you see bad makeup or a bad soundtrack that's not mixed properly, like.
And I mean, in a movie where you have two characters like that, you have to make sure the sound in your actual movie is top notch. And in this movie, the sound level is quite good.
Oh, it is. And actually, I watched this movie on a pair of headphones, and I'm glad I did because I really was able to appreciate the sound in this movie and how it was edited and how it really contributed to the overall tone and feel of the picture.
Well, since you were talking about the makeup tutorial, let's listen to a little bit of her talking about her profession to John Travolta.
What's the first thing you see when you meet somebody?
Legs. I'm a leg man.
No, that's not what I mean. Come on.
All right. Face. You see the face, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
So if your face doesn't look right, no one, I mean no one, is gonna look at you again.
Yeah, but I don't think your face needs any makeup.
Every face needs makeup, but it shouldn't look like makeup.
Oh, I see.
You see, I've worked on this face. I've hidden everything so you don't see the makeup.
You got makeup on now?
I do.
I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
Absolutely. And you see, this took me 2 hours. And this is the no makeup look.
Really? Well, I would like to see what the makeup look looks like. I bet that's good, huh?
Why? I only do that for special occasions.
How about a broken nose? How would you deal with a broken nose?
Well, that's easy. You just take like a little... Wait a minute, let me see if I can show you. Yeah, like you get a brush like this, right?
Yeah.
You take a little brown powder, you just kind of make a little brown...
What are you doing?
Hey, now wait a minute. This is serious business here. You interested
or not? Oh, yes, okay, sorry.
Okay. You make a brown line, you kind of smudge it in right here. I mean, it has to be real subtle so no one notices it or anything like that. But what are you smiling about?
I'm impressed. I'm impressed that you know so much about this.
You're not interested in this at all.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not. You just kept me sitting here talking so I'd miss my train.
Wait, no, that's not true, Sally. Look, I just didn't want you to go.
Why?
Because I like you and I just met you and you're going off on me.
No, I'm not. I don't know anything about you.
What do you want to know? I'll tell you anything you want to know.
All right, you're a Sandman, right?
Yeah.
Okay, how'd you get that job?
That's a good question. I don't know.
And I think that scene also points out that they do have pretty adorable chemistry.
Yeah, no, they are great. I really enjoyed that conversation. Again, very naturalistic sounding to me, like they're actually talking with each other about this stuff, you know.
It's funny that you mentioned that whole thing about their jobs are, you know, their level of expertise is measured by how much you don't notice what they're doing. She even says that in the scene.
Yeah.
She even said in that scene, the best makeup is when you don't see it. And she even says, like, I'm wearing the no makeup look right now to make it look like as little as possible that I'm actually wearing makeup, which is that's so many layers to that conversation now.
Now, we also have to mention, too, that this scene is the culmination of a whole aspect of this film that looks very strange with modern eyes, where he saves this girl's life and then immediately tries to fuck her. I mean, I'm not saying that he literally is trying to fuck her, but it's clear that that's what his objective is. Ultimately, it's like, oh, I've saved this pretty girl's life. Maybe this is my in, you know, I mean, like when he was in the hospital, first off, when he's in the hospital and he gets out of bed and he goes walking through the hospital, just smoking a cigarette casually. I thought that's a wonderful reflection of this era.
Mm-hmm.
And then, he immediately goes into the room and he wants to talk to her, but she's all fucking drugged up. And then ultimately the hospital's just like, yeah, you know what? We'll send this drugged up girl off with this greasy sound engineer we don't know anything about, and he can take her home. just puts her entire into her possession, or into his possession, to deal with as he wishes. But thankfully, he's at least, you know, he's not a complete scumbag.
I think you make a good point. Definitely a different era. Less acceptable now, or less acceptable then, just not spoken of. But yeah, no, I think he kind of doesn't fall completely into that, because Travolta's got this like natural charm.
Yes.
Especially in that era. And he seems like he plays this character as such meaning well kind of guy, like means well. Doesn't True. I mean, to his credit, he doesn't try anything when she's drugged up. So
no, I give him that. But he also, when he's trying to convince her to go for a drink, he does pull the life-saving card. because he really does want to go for this drink, because he really does want to fuck this girl, but he wants to do it right.
I'm just gonna say this, and maybe this is a hot take. I think if you save someone's life, they should at least have a drink with you.
I'm not saying
it has to lead to anything. I'm just saying,
just a little handy under the table, just fiddle with it for a minute. That's all I ask.
I did not say that, Jason.
That's like you say that every time I see you.
I keep saying your life.
It's not relevant. Well, yeah, I mean, you did, but look, I've already done it many times, Brendan. I think we're even.
Listen, I made it so that you didn't have to watch Chairman of the Board, and I want some goddamn appreciation.
We'll work this out when the quarrel is over.
Wait, the Aaron Eckhart film?
Yes. when that movie finishes, we'll talk about this.
You're still watching it? Are you watching it in like 2-minute increments?
It's all I can really handle.
That's fair. But yeah, so that's a good point there. That is a really interesting scene. And you know what, Jason, now that we talked a little bit about the sound in the movie and how well it's utilized in the movie itself, in Blowout, I want to play, and this is going to be fairly quiet for most of it, but I do want to play a section of when Travolta is recording sound just before the car accident, because this is some fantastic sound design, just foreboding and like eerie without being like overt.
And remember, kids, they mixed this stuff on probably all the same equipment that this movie is like, that's in this movie. Like they had to do this all analog back then with multi-tracks, and it's nuts the amount of work that would have gone into it compared to today, just, you know, using Audacity or whatever Adobe's audio editing is, you know.
We're living on Easy Street, kids.
I know, we really are.
this is John Travolta had to go out and record these sounds for real.
Yeah, on real tape, and he only had so much of it.
That's right. So here we go. Let's listen to a little bit of this and appreciate the work. Jason, I want to point out something else that I noticed there. That's not in the clip, but when he's recording the sounds and the car crashes, I don't know, I didn't notice it at all when until I watched it back to grab that clip because, you know, I wasn't really paying attention to this. But, you know, obviously later in the movie we found out Dennis Franz was recording it because he's trying to catch the governor in a tryst and sell it to this this other candidate, right?
Mm-hmm.
You actually see him run off in that opening scene.
Oh, do you? I didn't see that. I see him. I only first saw him when Travolta runs down to jump in the water to save the girl. You see him kind of step out from behind the bridge and take off.
Yeah. Oh, that's what you mean, right?
That's what I'm talking about. Is that what you were talking about?
Yeah, no, that's what I mean. But I saw it like in the first scene.
Oh, okay. Crazy.
So
Did you see the flash in that clip? I don't know if that was supposed to be the gunshot or if that was supposed to be the camera flash, but there was a flash of light in that shot. I didn't notice the first time through.
I think that's supposed to be the gunshot, but I'm not 100% sure. But I do know that when I watched it back and saw, you know, the background of like Dennis Franz running off.
Yeah.
I thought, man, that's smart. There's no attention given to it. It's so in the background, but it's one of those things you watch back and appreciate the second time you see it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I just love that. Yeah. I don't have any other big like things I want to talk about, but is there anything else you wanted to mention from this movie?
Yeah, I got a couple things. First off, I love the whole look of this movie. Like part of it is the era that it's filmed in, but like we really get a nice look at, is this Philadelphia? Is this
Philadelphia? Yes.
Yeah. We get a really nice look at Philadelphia in 1981 and kind of like how the world was then, like in that beautiful, the train station, the central station there, and you've got the banks of phone, the phone booths and everything. And then out on the street and everybody's smoking everywhere. And they go through that market and you see all the market stuff and everything. Like it added such texture to everything. I mean, maybe that wasn't necessarily the intent at the time, but in the intervening years, you know, this movie was 37, 38 years ago. Like, it's just cool to see all that stuff. I really appreciated that. And I appreciate that, like any movie that's like that, where it's set in a city and it just kind of shows what things were like at that time. So that holds up. I give it that.
I do like how that thing you mentioned, I do like how it has a look that's like, it doesn't feel like Taxi Driver gritty,
no.
But it feels like a good slice of realism though.
Yes. I love the fetishistic attention to detail of showing all the sound equipment and stuff. Cause that, all that old school equipment is just so cool looking and so retro futuristic. I love it. I just was happy to see it all. There's one scene, and this is a very specific thing, and you'll have no reference to this, Brendan, I'm sure, but there's one scene where there's this like kind of bass track plays as when they're in the city, and it sounded very much like it was something that could have been in Persona 5, which is a Japanese role-playing game set in high school that I've played and has one of the grooviest soundtracks ever committed to you know, digital. But but I wonder if the guy that wrote the soundtrack from that had seen this movie or heard that bit of soundtrack, because it just sounded so much like the bass from that game. But that's just me. I mean,
there's a very good chance, Jason. This is a movie, I mean, while it didn't make a lot of money at the time, it's definitely one that's grown, it's grown its reputation over the years.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. And for good reason, because it's fantastic. One last thing I had to say before we get done here. I feel like there's an opportunity here for a remake of this movie again in the modern age. And in my head, I was thinking, well, obviously if you're going to do this movie today, cause we had a photographer and then we had a sound engineer, I mean, you might say that the next step would be like a video, like a camcorder or something, but that would be if they made the movie in the 90s. No, today it'd have to be like some Instagram influencer, like has to go to the park at night or something to record a video so they can get all those clicks. And they're like doing like a selfie thing and be like, hey, this is Johnny Dickhead and I'm recording in the park. And then in the background of Johnny Dickhead's video, there's like a lady getting stabbed or something and he catches it on screen and oh my God. And then he's like on the run.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, you know what? It already worked once. They did it with Disturbia and Rear Window. So there you go.
Sure. Yeah, exactly. He has to survive by going to businesses and promising lots of exposure to his followers if they give him free shit.
Somebody get Shia LaBeouf on the phone.
It's his time, finally.
Just do it.
As Shia LaBeouf once said, art is anything that moves you. So move us, Shia LaBeouf, and be in this Instagram influencer remake, which I haven't thought of a good title for, because obviously I wanted to go with Blow Something. Like, but I don't know what would be relevant. We'd have to come up with a plot element, because Blowout is relevant to the tire.
Social Blow. Blow.
Blowout. That's already
more. Or Viral Blow.
Viral Blow. Blow Down. Blow Me Down. That'd be a pirate movie.
Blow me down, beat me up.
Alternate title. Alternate title for The Lighthouse. Blow Me Down.
By the way, if anyone hasn't seen The Lighthouse, do yourself a fucking favor.
It's on Amazon.
It's so good. So good. Have you seen it?
No, I'm going to watch it. It's been sitting on my computer for quite a while. I'm going to watch
it. You will enjoy it.
Well, it was filmed in Europe, so.
It is decidedly fucked up.
All right.
We didn't talk a lot about Dennis Franz, but we should mention that he's a very much a cartoon character.
He is absolutely a cartoon character of a Chicago whatever, of a Chicago scumbag. And he's hanging out in Philadelphia.
Yeah, I mean, should we just play the one scene I have from him?
Please.
Of him and Sally.
He literally sounds like he's doing an impression of Dennis Franz.
He does. I do like that the scene starts out with, so we know obviously him and Sally are like in on this, you know, their various plots to embarrass rich people by being caught with her as a mistress. Yeah. And then they sell it to the highest bidder, like we said. And they're arguing right now because she feels guilty, obviously, that they were indirectly involved in getting this governor killed. The way he starts and the way he ends this conversation is what gets me. Let's just play this clip here.
Manny, we got him killed.
Oh, hey, wait, hey, what do you mean we, huh? We didn't do nothing. I was in the woods, you were in the car, I didn't shoot out my tire, you didn't either. So please, don't give me none of this conscience shit, huh? Besides, I mean, nobody is exactly crying over the way things turn out, you know what I mean? I mean, what would have happened if the guy had lived, huh? His career was finished, thanks to us. This way, the guy comes out ahead, huh? He's a saint, a martyr. Christ, they passed one of his bills this morning.
You're a pig, Manny. And I'm a pig, too.
Hey, what the hell is with this pig shit? What's the matter with you?
You gotta tell the truth before the books are closed and the loose ends are cut off.
Hey, what are you talking about?
McRyan was murdered, and everybody should know that.
Are you crazy? We got him killed. Do you want to go to jail?
Yeah, but I was in the car and you were in the woods.
You think anybody is going to believe that?
I don't know, but I got to do something.
Yeah, like just keep your mouth shut and take the money. Hey, babe, listen, this is the biggest thing since the Zapruder film.
I don't care.
It's bigger. I mean, this is history we got here, girl.
Not the accent, but for some reason, his manner of speaking just reminded me of like Eugene Levy.
Yeah. Like Eugene Levy doing a character. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, though, I just think it's funny in that scene where he goes from like, whoa, 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 we didn't do anything. Don't put that conscience shit. And then by the end of it, she says, well, I'm just going to go to the cops. And he's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. They're going to think we did it.
Yeah.
Like just like at one point, 180.
What does he say? The line where he's like, we're vultures, we're pigs. And he's like, oh, would you swallow a box of animal crackers in there?
Yeah.
And then he tries to rape her.
He sure does. And then she smashes a bottle over his head. And that's the last we see of him.
Yeah, thankfully, you know, that was good. Get rid of him. Like, and I could almost smell the booze coming off his breath when he gets like right in your face and is like, well, they're gonna think we did it.
Oh, I mean, he's got this, like, he's got a tank top. He's got literally a bottle of fucking wine in his hand.
His wife beater is literally stained with his supper.
Yeah. Let's talk about how this movie was received, Jason.
Yeah.
This movie opened in July of 1981 to positive reviews overall. So critically, it was liked from the get-go. Actually, one of the reviewers who gave this movie unconditional love was Pauline Kael, who, you know, is very divisive among a lot of film fans or, you know, people who read a lot of critics. Yeah. She actually said, De Palma has sprung to the place that Robert Altman achieved with films such as De Palma has sprung to the place that Robert Altman achieved with films such as McCabe and Mrs. Miller and Nashville, and that Francis Ford Coppola reached with the Godfather films. That is, to the place where genre is transcended and what we're moved by is an artist's vision. It's a great movie. Travolta and Allen are radiant performers.
Nice.
Roger Ebert says this movie is inhabited by a real cinematic intelligence. The audience isn't condescended to. We share the excitement of figuring out how things develop and unfold when so often the movie only needs us as passive witnesses. It was considered a disappointment. Obviously, it did not make its money back.
Yeah.
They actually had predicted at the time that it was going to make between $60 to $80 million. And I'm guessing that's because of Travolta's star power at the time.
Yeah, he was quite famous.
That obviously did not happen. It was, of course, this movie, though, it's one of Quentin Tarantino's three favorite movies, by the way.
Makes sense. It's fantastic. I understand.
Can you guess what his other two are?
Is one of them Foxy Brown?
No. They're not super obscure.
Oh, North by Northwest and we're going to say Beyond the Valley of the Dolls.
I love you, Jason. His three favorite movies are this one, Rio Bravo, and Taxi Driver.
Okay. Okay.
So he also said that he used the cue, one of the music cues from this in one of his own movies, in Death Proof.
Huh.
It's been described. Article on the AV Club listed it as the number one of De Palma's films, yeah. Saying it's the quintessential De Palma film. The study of a movie craftsman investigating a political cover up marries suspense, sick humor, sexuality, and leftist cynicism into an endlessly reflective study of art imitating life, imitating art.
Yeah.
So there you go. This high praise. Maybe go on record. I might have to look back and see what we watch for these again, but I think this is the best. And now for something completely similar that we've ever done.
Yeah, this is definitely the best movie we've watched in this run. And it kind of is interesting to compare it to the remake of Wicker Man, where I think they're very similar in that you have two filmmakers that appreciated the originals and wanted and liked that idea and wanted to do their own thing. And they did in both cases. It's just that this one, in my mind, worked so much better. And
it
was just such an enjoyable, thrilling film from start to finish. It improves upon, I believe, substantially upon Blow Up. Because I like Blow Up, but Blow Up was a very kind of low key. It was, you know, it was a movie that I yawned a lot during, but I did ultimately like it. But this movie, I was on the edge of my seat the whole time. It was fantastic. And as I said before, and I kind of want to bring it back around just to get this one last thing across, the comparison between this and Blow Up is to me very much like a comparison of cultural attitudes of British and American filmmakers, because that British version, it's like at the end of it, it's like, oh, look, he was crazy the whole time. In my mind, it's like, you know, it's the question is open, but it's like it's pretty clear he's crazy a little bit. Whereas in this one, at the end of it, it's not that he's crazy. He's completely sane. And we know this throughout the whole movie, but it's at the end of it, he is completely fucking traumatized by everything that happened and is going to have to deal with that for the rest of his life. And I just find that so different. The perspectives of the two countries, it's just a fun comparison, but but so good. So good.
It doesn't make the full American comparison in that it doesn't have a tied up happy ending.
No, certainly not.
So that shocked me. The ending of this movie genuinely shocked me. And I think it shocked audiences at the time. The general consensus of the ending at the time was people saying like, well, hold on. You can't end a thriller like that.
You can't though.
You can. And they did. And I think it's one of those, I mean, I feel like we get this too much nowadays with horror movies, is where you're like, oh, the bad guy won again. Nothing's tied up. End on an open ending. We might get a sequel. But I think this is done that obviously this is done a lot differently, and it's you feel like it's not done just for that purpose of like, no, leave it open ended for a blowout two.
Yeah, exactly. We don't need that. It'll never happen. But yeah, it's just that ending is so perfect for this movie. It just it sticks it so hard. And I haven't seen a movie with an ending this good in quite a while. Mm. I mean, yeah, that's just, it really drove it home, and I'm enchanted by it.
Enchanted.
Yeah, that's my word. That's the
call
word.
Jason Ella because he's enchanted.
Let it go. Let go.
That's a different movie. Different movie.
Plus, what do I know?
You have Disney Plus. Don't fucking lie to me.
I don't.
Well, well, I think that'll do it for Blowout then. There was a lot to talk about. That was a really dense movie.
Fucking good movie, Brendan. My God, yeah. I'm so glad we watched this. I'm glad that this came up in the run, because normally it wouldn't, because it's not British. But it was a good excuse to watch it.
I mean, hell, it was connected to Blow Up, so fuck it.
Exactly.
Jason, we're gonna continue this a little bit more, just because we're in the midst of the core still. And we're going to delve into a couple more movies, just two more. And
yeah, ideally we like doing the main list when we're face to face, but we're still not sure on how long that's going to be. So, right. We're going to maybe do a couple more of these type of movies, cause it's fun and it's our podcast and we can do whatever we want.
We're also realistic, which is why we're only doing about two more of these probably.
Yeah, exactly. Then regardless of what's going on, we got to get back to business. Even if America can't open up for screening countries,
For screening country is going to open up in 2 weeks.
It's going to be a grand, big, beautiful opening. It's going to be the biggest, most beautiful opening you ever saw. The ratings are going to be fantastic.
Oh,
because that's what matters, Brendan, ratings.
I just puked in my mouth.
Yeah. Hashtag fire Fauci.
Oh, Jesus. Don't even stir. So we're going to go back to another. This is going to be interesting, though. We talked about St. Trinian's just last week.
We did.
And now we're going to talk about the much-beloved sequel, St. Trinian's 2, The Legend of Fritton's Gold.
And you know it's a good sequel when it references the greatest sequel of all time, City Slickers 2, The Legend of Curly's Gold.
Yeah, if you're going to, like you said, Jason, if you're going to steal
from the best.
That's right. So we're going to talk about that movie next week. Now,
if you'll remember last week, I unreasonably enjoyed St. Trinian, so I'm curious to see how this one's going to play out.
Well, we'll see how this 14% Rotten Tomatoes movie.
Oh, I can't wait.
Hey, 45% audience, so you never know.
You never know.
So we'll talk about St. Trinian's 2, The Legend of Fritton's Gold. And then the week after that, we are going to talk about a movie that's not really related to anything on the list, but it's going to kind of fit in with our current world situation. So
absolutely.
More on that next week. But as for now, you can find us on Twitter at @BFI_pod. You can find us on Facebook. Just search for Screen
and Country.
You can find Jason on Twitter
at Jason D. McLeod, that's MacLeod, and listen to me complain about people leaving their homes.
And you can also, if you look at his tweets very carefully, there are images of people being murdered.
You have to find the right ones, though. It's very spread out, it's very obscure, but I'm sure you can do it.
They're mostly the retweets from InfoWars.
Well, those guys just keep me informed. That's in their name. Info.
Jason, don't you know that in Venezuela they're eating rats?
They're eating rats and they're turning the frogs gay.
So that's that. Fuck. You can find us on all the podcatchers. Forescreenandcountry.podbean.com. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, all that good stuff. We are running long tonight, so I am trying to wrap this up as quickly as humanly possible. With all that being said, I just got one thing to say to you.
Say it.
God save the queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screen and Country, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
click. I just took some audio.
Oh no, don't use it to prosecute me in court because I murdered that person. Did you have the audio on? Were you recording?
I was.
Damn it! Can't seem to face up to the facts. I'm tense and nervous and I can't relax. Can't sleep cause my bed's on fire. Don't touch me, I'm a real live wire.
That, my friend, is the film Blow Up. Nope. I'm going to do that again. All right, let's try it again.
And now the film Set It Off.
It's time. Let's check our cue, baby. Pair it with a couple brews, baby. We love your movies. We love the bad ones too. So we watch them all and pass their lessons on to you. Oh yeah. Bana 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 bana
bana bana bana bana. Everything I learned from movies helps to make life a little bit groovy. Where the one last plot holes are gratuitous movies. It's time to get busy with your friend Steven Izzy.
At EILFM.podbean.com.
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.